Is it also collection which is sold?
The whole collection will be sold. Yeah, it will be over, it's about 400 pieces, and it was Christo's will to sell his collection, and all the proceeds will go to his family, so his son and his son family. And yeah, it's a very heterogeneous collection because it was never meant to be a real collection as a collector would intend it. You know,
Yes.
the collection that naturally developed and grew by itself, because most of the works were not even purchased by Christo and Jean-Claude. They were given, they were traded, they were exchanged with artists and friends. That's why you have this enormous variety of works from different periods and by different artists. And that's the reason why it's so special.
I was surprised to see that he bought at MAG the Miro, for example.
Yeah, he did.
That's surprising, right?
That's amazing. Yeah, he loved that piece. He really loved it, especially because it was very textural. You know, Christo always loved the texture of the surfaces, and that sculpture definitely was.
Yeah, it's a very peculiar piece for
And
Miro even.
it's very special. You're right.
Do you think he met Miro?
No, they never met. They never met in person. I know for sure.
What about the Duchamp comes from Tini Duchamp?
It comes from Tini Duchamp, yes, and because Duchamp was a great supporter of Christo's work, and they met for the first time in Milan in 1963, at the same time when Christo and Jean-Claude met Fontana for the first time at Christo's opening at Guido Lenoci Gallery, at his personal exhibition, I Pacchi di Cristo. And Duchamp was there because he was visiting Arturo Schwarz, his galleries in Milan.
Of course.
They met and they like each other very much. And Duchamp has always been extremely supportive of Christo's work. And when Christo moved to New York, they found, of course, the four of us, Tini, Duchamp, Christo, and Jean-Claude, found themselves in New York. And they spent a lot of time together. Duchamp was visiting very often Howard Street and Christo's studio. He was very fascinated by his work and his creative research. And they would have dinner very often here, but Duchamp was always described as very silent, and Tini was very lively. So it was somehow the same balance between Christo and Jean-Claude. Christo was always very shy and not very social, and Jean-Claude was, you know, the front man. She was the real, you know, speaking person. And before Duchamp left for Europe, actually a few months before he died in 68, Christo was working on the Rock Coast for Sydney in Australia. And Duchamp wanted to visit Christo's studio one last time. So he came here and he spent quite a bit of time in the studio looking around because he was looking for something to take with him. And he chose a Rap Coast collage. Christo always said that he always had the impression that Duchamp didn't believe that he would make it, but at the same time was very attracted by the idea of rapping the coast in Australia. So he chose that work, and Tini's family confirmed me that that collage is still on the same wall where she hung it when she went back to Paris. And then in exchange, Christo got the edition from La Grande Valise that was actually realized by Tini's daughter. She was
But
the
it was an exchange because in the catalog it's written that it's Tini who gave
Yes, a
the
few
Grand
months,
Vert.
yes.
So
Remembering that Duchamp took the rap cost.
okay. And
Because
but it's true.
Christo, Jean-Claude, and Tini remain in contact even after Duchamp's death.
And but normally the all the pieces of boîte-en-valise are made on purpose for the boîte-en-valise. So from what boîte-en-valise does it come? It's strange, no?
It comes from the boîte-en-valise that Tini's daughter was realizing with Marcel at that time.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
So it means there's a boîte-en-valise without le grand verre?
Well, that's it, actually. You have it.
Mm. So the owner of la boîte en valise without le grand verre need to buy it.
Apparently, yes.
What about Fontana? So what was the relation with Fontana?
As I said, Fontana, actually the first time that Crystal met Fontana's work, not Fontana in person, was in Germany in 1958 through...
How do you know all that? This is crazy.
Yes, I mean, I should, right? Shouldn't I?
That's impressive.
So in 58, Christo was in Germany because he was invited by Dieter Rosenkranz, one of his very first collectors, to spend the summer in Wuppertal. And then he actually made friendship with many artists there. And he also met Alfred Schmela, one of the galleries who gave Christo his very first personal shows. And Alfred Schmela was also the gallerist who introduced Fontana's work to Germany. So Christo saw Fontana's work there, and then he saw it again in Paris. And Fontana saw Christo's work at Schmela. So they saw each other's work, but they never met. And then it finally happened in Milan, and Fontana actually even confessed to Christo that he's bought two rat cans from Schmela many years before they met, because he's admired his work. And he was known to be a sort of mecenate for young artists, like he did for Yves Klein, for instance. He was buying, you know, young artists' work to support him. And then they met in Milan. They liked very much each other. And Fontana liked Jean-Claude especially. She said that he was a charmer. He was always extremely elegant. Christo said that Fontana was definitely the most elegant artist he's ever met in his life, because he always had a suit, no matter what. Even in his studio, he always had a suit. So they had dinners and lunches together, and Fontana invited Christo and Jean-Claude to his studio several times, so Christo could see him working and could see the whole environment of Fontana's studio, which was really the place to be in Milan at that time, because everybody went there and everybody wanted to be there. Exactly the opposite as Duchamp's studio in New York, for instance. There was a sort of secret, mysterious place where nobody knew what he was actually doing. And one day Fontana asked Jean-Claude to choose a work from the works that they were in the studio, and she picked the natural canvas that was part of the collection, and he dedicated it to her on the back.
Ah, okay. And what about Klein? Yves Klein,
the two met in Paris, of course. And Yves Klein was really, you know, on the spotlight in those years. And Christo was definitely not, because he was, you know, new in town and he was a foreigner. And he was close to the new realists, but he's never been part of them. He was never even asked to join formally the group.
Oh, okay.
Klein was always a little bit skeptical about Christo's work. Especially at the very beginning, and then suddenly everything changed when he was about to marry with Rutrot, who was already pregnant, and she was looking for a wedding dress. So Jean-Claude was married before she married Christo, and she had a very pompous wedding, and she had a beautiful Christian Dior dress that she clearly didn't need anymore. So knowing that Rutrot was looking for a wedding dress and they were about the same size, she offered Rutrot to wear her dress and to keep it.
Wow.
Yeah, Rutrot was very impressed. But who was mainly impressed was Yves Klein, because he knew clearly that Jean-Claude was the daughter of the General de Guillebon. And he was also very attracted by the whole military war. He likes uniforms, and that's why even in the wedding and in the wedding portrait that Crystal realized for him, he's wearing a high uniform. So they started to become closer, and Yves Klein even asked Crystal to collaborate, to create some works as a collaboration, like a four hands work. And he actually, Crystal actually even wrapped Gilles, one of Yves Klein models in 62, in Yves Klein apartment. And then Yves Klein proposed Crystal to realize his wedding portrait in very academic portrait as the portrait that Crystal was, you know, painting to make a living, assigning them as Javachev in those years where he was in Paris. And Crystal was supposed to paint both Yves and Rutrol. And then Yves Klein was supposed to, and he did actually, supposed to paint the background, typical blue. And then he would affix one of his typical classic golden sponges on the background. So Crystal does his part, Yves Klein does the background, and the sponge was never affixed because Yves Klein died. So you can see actually the marks where he was going to fix a sponge, but the sponge was never there.
Wow.
And, yeah, and then
they were not superstitious because Jean-Claude didn't stay married long time. And when was pregnant of Christo, she gave the dress to Yves Klein and he died. Wow, where is his dress?